As sci-fi as they sound, genetically modified crops aren't a new thing. In fact, genetically modified, or GM crops for short, were commercialized as far back as 1996. Resistance to pests or drought, improved yield or nutritional values are all possible with a touch of genetic tinkering. This video will look at one example of a modification originally made in 1987 that is still in wide use today. Welcome to the genetic basis of stuff and things. In 1997, we find ourselves at the genesis of GM crops for commercial use. That year, 1.7 million hectares of them were grown globally. By the turn of the millennium, that number had risen to 44.2 million hectares. 148 by 2010, and 190.4 by 2019. However, genetically modifying organisms to change their traits wasn't necessarily new at the time. But how do you genetically modify a plant? After all, you can't just put a leaf on a petri dish and use an antibiotic to select for the mutation, right? Well, this 1985 paper describes a way of putting new genes into morphologically normal plants. It relies on the fact that strains of Agrobacterium will transfer a section of their genetic code into the plant they infect. By removing the harmful genes from that section they transfer, and replacing them with the genes we want, we can get the bacteria to add in our custom segments for us. By infecting small discs of leaf material from your plant of choice, then growing them on a medium that induces the leaves to grow shoots, you now have your original plant that will contain and express your custom segment of DNA. And to confirm that it worked, you can use antibiotics such as kanamycin that can kill plant cells. By including an antibiotic resistance gene in the transferred segment, you can use this to select for the plants that have been successfully transformed. As an example of a GM crop, let's look at a 1987 paper developing one. Mark Veek and his team used the process I just explained to genetically modify a tobacco plant to be all but immune to attack from a moth and its larvae. In fact, this type of modification eventually developed into a whole line of so-called BT crops. But what exactly was the modification that makes this possible? Meet the BT2 gene from the bacterium Bacillus thuringiensis. It codes for a protein toxic to insects, specifically against Lepidoptera and sometimes Diptera and Coleoptera. Its viability is proven already, since spore preparations of this bacterium had already been in use for decades as a traditional insecticide. 5 different DNA configurations were trialed in their experiments to see which one performed the best. Each chimeric gene contained various trimmed sections of the BT2 toxin gene. Each also featured a two-sided promoter and a kanamycin resistance gene for use in selection, some of which are fused to the BT gene segment. But did it work? After transforming the plants with the new genes, they were grown, then exposed to pest larvae of the tobacco hornworm, a major pest of interest in this case. The following is what they observed. The plants expressing the whole, uncut BT gene had tenuous insecticidal activity, killing some of the larvae, inhibiting others, or barely having an effect on some. The ones expressing the longest of the trimmed sections had a decent insecticidal effect, but the two shortest trimmed sections were the best by far. The one expressing the BT-NPT860 fusion protein with a 100% mortality rate across the board in the 6 days tested. Why is this important? Well, this experiment successfully gave a plant a gene of a bacterium by using another bacterium. Imagine what other genes and from what other organisms could completely transform the performance of all the crops we rely on day to day. Imagine all the ways they could be spliced and diced to improve or modify their effectiveness. By 2017, about 100 million hectares of BT crops were grown around the world. And years of growing them has yielded only good results. The specificity of the BT toxin is good enough to show little to no activity in non-target organisms, unlike typical wide-spectrum pesticides. And anything that doesn't feed on the plants won't be exposed to the toxin at all. No runoff. And this is just one example of the power of genetically modifying a crop plant. Different types of GM crops can solve different issues, like improving drought resistance, encouraging more efficient use of herbicides or fertilizers. In short, they allow us to use less resources to grow more crops with less harm to the environment.